Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All of us and help us to make decisions that we can keep a clear conscience about. Be with our nation as we go through a heavy election process. Help us to examine the issues, examine the potential leaders, and make our choice accordingly. Be with our military worldwide as they defend us against the people who would love to see harm brought to us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Tim. Call the meeting to order. This is the first meeting of our September Board of Commissioners. Thank you all for attendance. I apologize for the change in the time. Appreciate everybody accommodating your schedule. Do want to announce that Vice Chair Bill Ashley is out of town this week, will not be in attendance. Mr. Albright, to confirm, we still have a quorum conducted.
We do.
Necessary. First item on the agenda is for the approval of the agenda. I'm sorry, we're going to do the public comments first for what happened last time. Let me talk about that. I'm still getting used to this. Thank you, sir. Let me make a comment about the public comments. If you are here tonight for the public hearing on the specific incentive request and the discussion on sheets, it is not necessary for you to sign up for the public comment period. You will have time for that discussion later. In our meeting, the public comment period that we're going to address now will allow individuals who have signed up with Sherry to have up to 3 minutes to talk about whatever you would like to talk about. If you are here for that and not for the public hearing and did not sign up, please raise your hand now so we can add you to the list. If you signed up for the public comment and are here to discuss the sheets incentive package, let me know when I call your name. You will not need to talk at this time. Does that make sense? Okay, well, we'll begin with the public comments, and we'll first call on Mr. Henry Vines, who wants to speak about the resolution amendment. Henry, welcome, sir.
Thank you, Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you tonight, and I'd like to, first of all, just thank you for changing the public comment before the agenda approval. I would like to make some comments tonight on the resolutions that y'all are proposing to make some amendments to. First of all, I would think that you would want all five commissioners here, since there's going to be a change of that, and I would think you might want to table that till all five of you could vote on that. Secondly, I just think y'all ought to do away with the resolution altogether. I don't think that we need a resolution to tell you or you to tell yourselves what you need to do with the money. You know what needs to be done for the county and for the best interest of this county. The quarter cent sales tax is indeed, in my opinion, a very viable source of alternative revenue for this county. And I think y'all ought to look at that as that way and spend that money in the appropriate way, whichever you need to do, whether it be toward this the ACC bond referendum, or it be toward the financial needs of this county. So I really think that you should come out and support publicly the quarter cent sales tax, that it would be a viable source of income for the county versus property taxes. Secondly, is the ACC bond referendum. Y'all have all talked about this and have unanimously agreed that this is a project that's needed at the community college. And you have put it on the ballot for us, the public, to vote on it, to approve or disapprove of this. Y'all have all spoke that this is necessary, that you think it's needed. Now you're asking the public for their approval. I think it's wrong if you're going to ask us for our approval to create a debt that the county would have to incur for this project, and then tie into it, well, if we don't get the money, we're not going to do it. It's y'all's responsibility to come up with the funds to fund this project if it's approved by the people. So I don't think that you should be tying these things all together. Either, you know, you're for it or you're against it. I personally am still standing on my position that at this time I don't think the county needs any further debt load right now. But y'all have all agreed and have spoke out in the favor that this is needed for the community college. And I think if it's approved by the voters, that you should fund this whatever it takes, if it's through the quarter cent sales tax or if it's indeed by a property tax. Thank you.
Thank you, Harry.
Thank you.
Next on the list is Robert Boyer, but Mr. Boyer, prior to introducing yourself, if you would clarify your subject matter, that I'm not familiar with that individual.
I want to tell you a story about a baseball player and enlist your help on something.
All right. You have 3 minutes.
Okay.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you doing, commissioners?
It's doubtful that Alamance County has ever produced a more colorful, controversial, or charismatic baseball player than Charles Wesley Jones. He was actually born Benjamin Wesley Rippey in 1852, and he was essentially Babe Ruth 45 years before the Bambino. At one point, he held the single season and the career home run. He was the single season career home run leader. He hit the second home run in National League history. He was a popular, handsome, a fan favorite. He was also a great ball player. On June the 10th, 1880, he became the first big leaguer to hit two home runs in the same inning. Now, I said all that to say this: he's an Alamance County native. A lot of people don't know that. Matter of fact, hardly anybody knows that other than me and a few other baseball geeks. But like many 19th century players, Jones fell on hard times, and he died in obscurity. He was so obscure that a reporter didn't track down what happened to him until more than three years after he died. He died on June 6, 1911 in New York City, and the reporter didn't find out what happened to him until December of 1914. Now, at this point, you might be asking yourself, you know, why should I care about this? Well, like many early players, Charlie Jones lies in an unmarked grave. He's in Allface Cemetery, Allface Lutheran Cemetery in Queens, New York. Now, it just doesn't seem right to me that someone who was so instrumental and a county native and who was so instrumental in the early history of baseball should be lying in an unmarked grave. So I want to ask you two things. One, I was hoping that the commissioners could start a fund and just put in a token amount, because there are other people who are interested in, I think, giving to this endeavor, and to the point where maybe we could raise enough money to buy a modest headstone to put on his grave. The other thing is that I think in a small way, I'm not going to try to oversell this, that this could help with tourism to some degree. I mean, we have a guy who was, as I say, at one time held the single season home run record and was the career home run leader through 1885, and was just a heck of a ball player. So I think if we could maybe petition the state to get like some sort of, you know, one of those silver markers, that might be something, worth looking into. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. I think this is a worthy endeavor. I think that this gentleman shouldn't languish in obscurity any longer, and I just ask that you would consider that, and I thank you for your time.
Thanks, Robert.
I hit it right on 3 minutes.
You did.
You did.
You did. Next on our list is Peter Childers, the man responsible for changing our order of public comments. Welcome.
Hardly. Yes, good. Thank you. Good evening.
I'd just like to commend commissioners for voting against Carver's request to dump their garbage in our landfill. It showed some long-range foresight. In that vein, I think what I'd like to see some discussion on is in future, we may get more of these requests. To me, it's such an important public issue that I think it should be turned into a public hearing issue and not simply a decision that commissioners can make without a public hearing. So I'm requesting that at some point, maybe there would be some discussion on this and turning that issue, future issues that might come up on this landfill, into public hearing status or however that's worded. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Craig, we really were just reconfirming a policy in effect, were we not?
Yes,
and addressing
sir.
That,
yes,
which normally wouldn't be accompanied by a public hearing.
Unless we were changing that policy.
Right. Okay, our fourth speaker is Mr. Tom Boney from the Alamance News. I do want to say Mr. Boney approached me right before the meeting and wanted to know if it would be appropriate for him to speak now or as it relates to specific agenda item number 7, which is not part of the public hearing. And I committed to Mr. Boney that if he made his comments now during public comment that we would address and respond to his concerns when we talk about number 7. So, Tom, welcome to you.
Mr. Chairman, I have shared with the members of the board and with the county government my very strong concerns about actions taken by the county manager at a meeting on August the 23rd in which he solicited to city officials, city and town officials throughout the county to endorse the referendums that the board has already put on the ballot. My question that I wanted to ask at this time is not with regard to that, but rather with regard to item number 7 and its origins in terms of being included on tonight's agenda. The difficulty, I appreciate the chairman's accommodation, but my question sort of leads to another comment depending on what I think the answer is. If I should anticipate the answer and go from there, I will. And then if I'm wrong, I'll guess it will be largely moot. But if you don't want me speaking at number 7, then I'll charge ahead.
Charge within the remaining 3 minutes that
gotcha.
You have.
All right. Mr. Chairman, I'm very concerned because I believe that 3 members of the board also attended that same meeting, yourself, Mr. Boswell, and Ms. Massey. And it seems to me that in doing so, in addition to Mr. Honeycutt's violation of one law by advocating for a public policy, the members of the board also engaged in a violation of the open meetings law. And the further evidence of that, I believe, is item 7 on tonight's agenda. The discussion at that meeting on August the 23rd was over changing the underlying resolution that applies to these various bond referendums. And as I understand the discussion, which the chairman and the county manager led, that was part of the discussion that night. And the result of it is tonight's agenda item. Mr. Chairman, I have asked that the commissioners not proceed on that item until public records are provided in connection with that deliberation which the 3 commissioners engaged in and perhaps with any other commissioners who were not present at the meeting. And so, Mr. Chairman, again, I'm sorry if this is premature, but I'm concerned that that's what y'all did and that that's where number 7 comes from, and I'd like to give you a letter outlining that in some greater legal background and concern about this item being on tonight's agenda, and strongly recommend that it be postponed till the board has complied with the open meetings law and allowed the public an opportunity to address the items, the philosophy that number 7 resolution represents. Thank you.
Thank you. And I will be happy to respond to that when we get to that item, as will Mr. Boswell, Mr. Massey, Commissioner Sutton, if they should not. That concludes our public comment period. Do we have any responses from the commissioners at this time?
We'd like to ask Bob. Bob, where was he born? Here,
he
Burley.
He was born in Foster's Township.
Do you know where he went to school?
Well, he moved away when he was a young boy to southwestern Indiana, and As a matter of fact, his origins are a little bit murky. We have a pretty good idea of where he was born, but not much after that until he later in his youth.
Well, and your comments were heard by county staff. Who would vote?
Brian's going to be probably the top man to look at that.
Can you look into that and just see a little bit more about what Mr. Boyer's talking about?
Yes, we spoke about it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay.
Now we need approval of the agenda.
We will continue our agenda order, and the next item is the approval of the agenda, which would include the consent agenda. We have two items on consent, one of the minutes. One is the release of the tax information, which is included, tax refunds and releases, which is included in the information. So board members, take a minute and see if there are any items that you'd like to change the order, remove, before we entertain a motion for approval of the agenda. Hearing no changes, I'll entertain a motion for approval, which will include the consent agenda items. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Before we move into the public hearing, which is the next item on the agenda, I would be more comfortable if our county attorney and county manager returned. Thank you, guys. The next item on the agenda is a public hearing, and what we will be reviewing is the issue of public hearing on proposed Sheets Economic Development Incentive, $32 million in investment, approximately 253 full-time jobs. Each year, $1.12 million county incentive over a seven-year period once the benchmarks of jobs and investments have been met, $160,000 annually over 7 years. So at this time, we'll entertain a motion to open the public hearing set and approved by the Board of Commissioners at our August 20th meeting. Is there such a motion to open a public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Madison. Mr. Boswell, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Craig, do we want to hear from anyone before the members of the public as way of background or update, or do you want to go right into the public hearing at this time?
Mac, is there somebody from Sheets who
wants to? Yes. All right.
Would you like for them to present first,
yes.
Mac?
Yes, if I may.
Sure. Welcome.
Thank you. My name's Mac Williams. I'm president of the Chamber of Commerce, Alamance County Chamber. And in that role, on behalf of Alamance County, I perform the economic development function. In that role, I've had the pleasure of working with what is now Sheets, started out Project South Park. Also with me tonight, I have, in addition to company representatives, whom I'll introduce in a moment, I also have a representative with the North Carolina Department of Commerce who was representing the state of North Carolina, who was very instrumental in this effort as well. I also have representatives of the consulting firm that represented the company in all their negotiations and in all the due diligence they did during the site selection process. So I want to welcome those folks and thank them publicly for the good work that they did in helping this process get to this point. I am going to introduce to you two people who are with the company. One will be the speaker representing the company. That man's name is Ray Ryan. He is the Executive Vice President of Sheets Distribution Services. Accompanying Ray this evening is Tony Sassano, who is an industrial engineer in their global supply chain management. Global may have been a bit stretched, but in their supply chain management system. And so Tony and Ray are here representing the company. In addition, I have got some material that they have provided, and I'll give to each of you. Also, there are some slides that Ray will use to introduce and help explain the company and what they're looking to do here. So while we get that all set up and going, I'll hand this out to you while Ray comes to the mic. And again, Ray Ryan.
Thank you, Mac. Mr. Ryan, welcome to you, sir. Welcome to Alamance County.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, appreciate the time. It might be a couple over three, but I'll go quick.
Well, I should have said for all of the members that wish to speak, in a public hearing, there is not a 3-minute time limit. So I say that with somewhat fear.
Sure.
But we'll try to make it make sense. Welcome again.
Well, we appreciate the audience, and we are a family-owned business since 1952. So in here our 60th year, we're celebrating this year. We have 428 stores currently under operation, over 14,000 employees, have been growing at a rate of over 10% a year for the last 4 years. North Carolina is a priority state for us. We have 41 locations opened. We will open 50 more within the next 5 years. One thing I'm really proud of, even though we haven't been in North Carolina very long, we've been voted as one of the best places to work in North Carolina with the program they have on the state level. We were also voted as best places to work in every state we operate in, which is 4 out of the 6 states we do business. And again, although we haven't been in Alamance County long, we have participated in the Special Olympics in Alamance County. We have Sheets Family Charities, where we take children Christmas shopping every year. And we've done that, as well as we're a sponsor at the Ace Speedway up the road. That's a little bit about Sheets, about distribution services. We began our retailing in 1952, as I said. In the early 90s, we started fuel distribution. That gave us the confidence that in 2001, we opened our current facility, which I think Tony has up on the screen. That's located outside of Altoona. It's 390,000 square feet. There's a freezer, cooler section, as well as ambient. That facility we've been running since 2001. Tony, could you go back one slide? We do distribution through a fleet of 56 trucks, serve all 428 stores out of there, 50,000 store deliveries each year, and those particular drivers log over 3 million miles a year. Our next adventure was in 2008. We opened right behind the distribution center our Sheets Brothers kitchen facility. On the right side of the building is a RTE or ready-to-eat section, cold section for cold foods, and on the left side is where we make our donuts and sub rolls and things like that. Those products are delivered in, and Mac warned me that I spelt the third word Sheets wrong, but we name everything with an SH. Schmuffins, Schmagels, Sheets. So it really is correct. But those vans do 156,000 deliveries every year, and they drive over 5 million miles. We do annual production of over 27 million donuts. We do cinnamon rolls and cookies in the 20 million and 11 million range. As well as our sandwiches, wraps, and parfaits, we do about 11.5 million of those annually. Those products are all delivered fresh every day to every store. That is our campus in Claysburg, Pennsylvania, right outside Altoona. Bakery in the back, distribution center in the front. This is a rendering, conceptual rendering on White's Kennel Road, which runs across the bottom of the screen. On the right side is a driveway for employees that would go into work. They would enter in the top section there. We have an office area, common area, locker rooms, cafeteria. This facility will also have a wellness center. And that is choosing, could it have been anything else? But that's going to encourage people to get and improve their health care right on site. On the left side, we have the kitchen and bakery, and then down through the center, we have our warehouse, ambient, freezer, cooler, down towards the bottom. On the right side is where we plan to do expansion as needed. On the left side is our truck parking, and at the bottom black box is our truck facility. Each vehicle is washed every day, inside and out. So that's just conceptual at this point, but we wanted to give you some idea of what we had in store. This project got launched in 2010. We did a feasibility study and looked at a lot of different factors, but we knew with our growth, we wanted a facility in the South to support our Southern growth. And that's going to be in West Virginia, Virginia, and North Carolina, and I don't know beyond that, but that's on the next 10-year horizon. We had over 100 locations when we first announced we were looking for property. And our consultants helped us whittle that down to 20. We started visiting sites, and it really led us through Mac's hard work and the state's hard work to the couple sites we have left. And we would really, you know, appreciate and consider Alamance County a great place to open a facility. And if you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer those too. If not, I'll move on.
Ray, actually, I have one question. The truck facility, are you going to have any part of your business planned for tank farms, underground storage tank, fueling, or any of that related activity?
Nothing on the fuel side related to serving our stores. That's all done out of Greensboro. We will have some sort of tank on site to refill our trucks on a daily basis as needed, but that'd be the only consideration we would have.
Much like an individual satellite fuel station?
Yes, sir.
Any other questions for Mr. Ryan at this time?
Are there going to be some on the road there? I know it's just a regular two-lane. Are you guys providing some infrastructure there, or how's that the road coming into the property?
My understanding is that there is some funding for some DOT work along White's Kennel Road for lane widening if needed.
Right. Okay.
That's great. Thank you. We may call.
Okay. This is the time for questions. I didn't know if we were to listen to the whole presentation or ask questions intermittently or what. Will your workers be temporary at all, or will they be full-time, or a percentage be temporary? Or
They will be full-time. The jobs that were listed as the ones we create would be full-time. If business would spike, we would hire maybe some temporaries to get through that, but the job reference we made were full-time employees that we plan to have by 2018.
All right, so the 200 some that you're mentioning are full-time?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's my only question.
Thank you.
Okay.
Mac, you have other representatives at this time to speak, or you want to?
Ray is the speaker for the company. Mm-hmm. There are others here who I guess could add some perspective that was required in response to other questions, but.
Okay, well, why don't we just start over here and see who we have that would like to speak from the public, and then we'll get over here, and then if there's any wrap-up questions after that, we'll readdress them at that time. That's okay. Okay, first row, anybody would like to speak?
Yep.
Mr. Webster?
Would you like to have a short, very short speech?
Okay.
And I have some
very
sure. If you would like to. People to have some of this.
My experience with incentives goes back further than many of you have been on this earth. Where it is that the governing body of the borough in Alamance County is contemplating giving something in the neighborhood of $2 million to a company which may be locating in the area. This money is to come to taxpayers, including one who is a direct competitor of the one being subsidized. And I'm just taking one example here. This taxpayer has been meeting payroll, paying interest, paying bills, investing in his businesses, and paying lots of taxes to Burlington, Alamance, North Carolina, the United States over 41 years for all the tax money he paid. And over the years, taxpayer got virtually nothing but a hard time, maybe a visit after a robbery. Now take his money and give to a competitor of his. Dale's incentive history. There was a small business here in Alamance County, Burlington, in fact, which built, sold, and serviced computers. They were some of the best computers I ever used. On the rare occasion when we had a problem, we could get someone to either answer the phone or call back in 20 or 30 minutes speaking English. That little company was a taxpayer. Then Dale came on the scene as a tax getter. Every computer that Dale sold was subsidized by us taxpayers, including my friend, the computer manufacturer. And he could not compete. He went out of business. I mentioned that my knowledge of incentives goes back into the 60s. In the early 50s, members of a power player law firm of Texas and D.C. negotiated a contract with the what is officially called the Free Associated State of Puerto Rico, which had no voting representation in Washington. The deal was, we can get more for you with strong lobbying than a state can get with voting representation. And so they did. It became a tax haven. Mills were closed in North Carolina with the excuse there's just no demand for fill in the blank, pantyhose. While the same type of mill was being opened in Puerto Rico, I now defy anyone to demonstrate to me that any of these privileged places, Puerto Rico, Guam, Virgin Islands, and so forth, are now economically or socially better off. Those of you who know me know that I have stood solidly against this practice of what some people call incentives. I always refer to it as extortion and bribery. It is just not the way to have good, solid, dependable, respectable economic development. I'm sorry that some people feel that Joe's doing it, we got to do it. It reminds me of having my blanket stolen in the Army. And when I said some SOB stole my blanket, the drill sergeant said, well, you got to steal somebody else's. I said, I won't do it. If I steal anybody's, it'll be yours. I will not steal somebody else's blanket. Now, this is not a way to have solid, dependable, honest economic development. It won't work in the long run. The way to stop it, I keep saying, well, everybody else is doing it. Everybody else is not doing it. There are places, there are counties in Texas, towns in Texas, places all over the country that's not participating. I really would like to see seats here, but I don't want you taking money from this man who's been paying taxes here for 41 years, his company, and give it to Sheets, who's a competitor of theirs. Play on a level field. If you're going to give them money, give him money. Is that unfair? Been running a business myself here in the next county. Never ask for anything. After what they've done with the sidewalks over in Caswell County, I wish to hell they'd quit spending my money on that. Anyway, thank you for listening to me.
Thank you, Mr. Webster. Anyone else on the first row? About the second row, where Peter and Robert and John, Howard?
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Welcome back.
Okay, thanks. A bad penny, eh? All right, well, first of all, I want to welcome Sheets. Where they are, sorry. I buy gas at Sheets, or I have bought gas at Sheets. So I'm glad they're coming. But I must oppose the so-called incentives, which I consider subsidies. And I find it kind of funny a lot of times. I get a kick out of people that come here to ask for subsidies after they've spent some time out in their communities and talking amongst their friends, railing against government and how government is not the solution and how government is spending too much. And we've all got to, the government can't support people who shouldn't, don't need to be supported. And then they come here and pretty freely ask for government money. I don't know if the Sheets representatives are aware of it, they probably are, but this county has struggled with its budget over the last 4 years, and it's knuckled down considerably and had to make a lot of adjustments to and sacrifices that I doubt the Sheets family has had to make in the last 4 years. Revenues are down. There's strict budget controls on county departments. Recently, we just cut 7% for outside agencies. Not enough money for schools. No pay raise for county employees in the last 4 years. So that gives you kind of an idea of what we've done to try to control our spending and whatnot. But now we have a company that comes in here and wants money from this poor county, basically this poor county, or poorer than it was 4 years ago, I guess. This company, Forbes lists Sheets as number 58 of the top 100 private companies. They list their sales as $5.23 billion. $1 billion. But you see, they came into this community to make some more money. I mean, that's fine. That's great. I wish I was a part of that. And I think their success is speaks a lot to their management and to their business skills. But they chose this community and because it meets their business criteria, not because we're giving subsidies. And their first rule to trying to locate somewhere is to find out what makes good business sense, not who's giving the most money. But, you know, this subsidy is really only a part of the total subsidies that they're asking for. From this state, they're getting. They want a subsidy from Burlington, and they want a subsidy from the state of North Carolina. And the subsidy really is not the cake; it's just the icing on the cake. They don't need it. And I think they'd come here if there wasn't a subsidy. Quite frankly, I think that's to me that's this is the cruel joke that these companies play on these communities, pitting one community against another falsely. The county subsidy equals about $4,743 per job. But for every job they do not create in this agreement, they will only refund the county $500. There's something wrong about that math. 83% of the jobs pay about $24,000 per year, which is slightly higher than the federal poverty level for a family of four. $24,000 a year jobs don't buy houses. They don't add to the county's property tax base. The subsidy cancels the property taxes that would be paid by Sheets and leaves county property taxpayers with little in return for our gift. Why also does the county value a $24,000 job the same as an $83,000 job? As a job or two listed in that list you have that pay about $83,000. I don't know if those are family Sheets, family members or not. But this is not a fair return to our community for the size of the subsidy. Mac, I wish you'd start bringing jobs that to this community where 83% were $83,000 and the rest were $24,000. The county doesn't have an economic plan. We just throw money at wealthy companies who attempt to hold us hostage unless we pay up. Commissioners, there is no hostage. They will build this facility because it makes good business sense. And their decision, and this decision by them meets their long-term profit goals, not because we pay them subsidies. Stop giving wealthy companies housewarming gifts disguised as incentives, and I urge you to vote against this unnecessary subsidy. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. John? Welcome.
There too long.
Good evening, Commissioners. Thanks for the opportunity to speak this evening. John Oakes, Burlington. Current and past history confirms that governments are terrible investors. It is clear to anyone that takes the time to investigate this historic documented track record, crystal clear, to all rational and reasonable people. I say that to say this. We have a history in our country of what works and what doesn't work. But aggregately speaking, governments are terrible investors. A reasonable example is our present debacle. Only in government could we start a discussion about adding facilities at ACC through a bond referendum and end up with a vote for a bond referendum and a 0.25% tax rate, all for achieving the same objective. Last time I was here was in January the 9th, and I was here for this specific reason, to comment on incentives. And at that time, my comments about incentives offended Mr. Sutton. It is never my motive or intention to offend anyone. They're just my thoughts and opinions pertaining to government business incentives. I probably agree with Mr. Sutton on far more than we would ever disagree on. January the 9th, I took the opportunity to express my views on another incentive package to a local business that the commission was confronted with. I stated that in principle, I do not support monetary incentives from government to private business for all the reasons that these gentlemen just expressed. But that to dismiss consideration of any incentive plan at the local level on principle alone, in my opinion, was irrational, given the fact that this has become the norm at this point in our history, unfortunately. I suggested consideration should be given on a case-by-case basis until such time that we can address and change this practice at the state and federal level. And the rationale for that reasoning is that subsidies are now an accepted standard business practice within our state, communities, and nation. But it should be changed so that it is no longer a norm. I would disagree with the last gentleman respectfully. I do think incentives are a part of business rationale for where they do go, because any wise business person is going to consider anything that affects the bottom line. And if our neighbors next door are offering these incentives, it's not rational to suggest that it's not a part of their business plan. But if you refuse to consider each and every situation on a case-by-case basis until we have changed the law, it potentially always equals to hurting our residents here in Alamance County. I would suggest that if a bit, and I respect the senator here immensely, but I would suggest that if a business has been profitable in this county for 41 years, it's highly unlikely that even if subsidies that I in principle disagree with are given to a business to come here and create jobs, that business is going to go away. I encourage you to give serious consideration to this specific incentive on behalf of all the present unemployed residents of Alamance County who are looking for employment. I would also like for you to consider that if you do decide to give incentives, let the business run the business. Don't micromanage the business. Have you ever had a business? I've had a small business. If you would have asked me how many people I'm going to have in a year, I could say, well, you know, I don't know. I'd hate to be held to the, you know, with a gun to my head telling you I'm going to have to give back money if you choose to give me an incentive, because I am considering opening my business somewhere else because I have other opportunities where people are willing to pay me to come. But I say this with all due respect, because it's like I'm speaking, you know, fork-tongued here. I'm speaking out of the left side of my my mouth. I oppose in principle incentives and subsidies, and I realize that what I'm saying is very controversial, but I do think it is the norm. I respect men like this of integrity and principle, but the reality is it could affect this opportunity not coming here, so I just think it's a balancing act, and I'd appreciate your consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Robert, Howard? Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Board. My name is Howard Beatty, Graham. I agree with Mr. Webster. And what I see is, bottom line, is an issue of fundamental fairness. I have not had a problem putting gas in my car or finding convenience foods or fast foods anywhere, which is the business that Sheetz is bringing here. I don't believe their coming here is going to increase our gasoline sales, fast food sales, or convenience item sales. So what are we looking at? They're coming here for good business reasons. They're a growing company. But they're coming here essentially to displace stores that are already working here, and as Mr. Webster said, some been working here for 41 years and paying taxes. It's a good business decision for them. This is their plan. They've stated that this is their plan. They plan to open 50 more stores in North Carolina in the next 5 years, 10 stores a year approximately. And they want to open those stores principally between the Triad and the Triangle. And some in Southern Virginia, some in West Virginia. And Alamance County is a prime real estate property for what they want to do here, a distribution center. But why should we subsidize them? Why should our taxpayers and our convenience store operators subsidize somebody coming in to compete with them? I say it's an issue of fundamental fairness. Everybody might do it, but I don't think we ought to do it. I don't think everyone's going to do it. I don't think everyone is doing it. For myself, I find their stores clean, good looking. I happen to be a native of Pennsylvania, but I've pretty much decided that I've gone to a Sheetz store for the last time. If they want to compete on that type of playing field, they want government to force taxpayers to subsidize them to compete with someone else. That's not the type of company I want to do business with. And I would humbly and respectfully ask the board to vote no for this incentive package. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard. Mark, you are in Howard's seat. Would you like to speak?
Yes.
Welcome.
I heard a little bit about what Howard said, and I would like to echo that. Mark Hopp, I'm sorry. I would like to echo that. I think Alamance County is strategically placed on the map to be it's in a good spot. I don't think we have to offer incentives to bring Sheetz here. I also am from Western Maryland, so I'm very familiar with Sheetz. I would ask the board again to also vote no on this. I don't think it's the government's rightful role to pick and choose winners and losers. I think that we need to make the market even for everybody. Taking money from one group, the taxpayer, and giving it to a corporation, I find it to be an amoral issue. I totally disagree with it, and I would hope that the board would consider voting no on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Third row, where Chris? Chris, would you like to speak tonight?
No, sir.
Dr. Powell?
Yes.
Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Sam Powell, a resident of Burlington, and I'd like to just say that I've heard the comments about the incentives, and I don't think any of us like the idea where governments are being forced into paying incentives. But, you know, we've gotten to a point in society today where competition is real. Growth occurs along routes of transportation. We all know that. We think that, you know, we can sit back since we're on the interstate and it will come to us without us doing anything. We've run the infrastructure. We've got the water, the sewer. You know, we've got a wonderful community to live in. But what we don't have is jobs. And without jobs, we're going to lose our tax base. We're going to lose our ability to maintain what we have. And I think we have to go out and really fight with the other competitors to get those jobs. You can call it incentives. You can call it investment in the future. But if we don't offer what other people are offering, we're not just making the difference of making us look a little bit better. You know, they're not going to consider us even if there's no incentive offered. So you take yourself, I think, out of the game without the incentive. There are, from what I understand, Sheets is looking at several potential locations, and the reason that they're looking at us, including us, is that we have, you know, in the past, we have offered incentives. We have a program through the county where we have a practice of doing incentives. And I just say, you know, until that changes, if we want to have jobs, if we want to continue to grow, incentives are out there, and that we have to deal with that. We have a 10% or better unemployment. We need some jobs. I hope you'll support this request. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Powell. Randy Perkins?
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. I'm Randy Perkins, and I'm the owner of Prime Personnel Resources, and I'm also the board chair for the Chamber of Commerce. And I really appreciate the commissioners giving consideration to this proposal, and I hope you'll vote affirmative for this proposal. And I really appreciate Sheets considering Alamance County, North Carolina, for their next site. As you know, I'm in the staffing business, and we have 20 to 30 people a day walk through our doors and apply for jobs. 100 to 130 people a week. Now that's a lot of people that's out of work. Some of these people have been out of work for a week. Some of them been out of work for two or three years. We need these jobs in Alamance County. Sheets will bring 250 jobs to this area. This is a win-win for Alamance County. It's also a win on the side of tax base, bring $30 million new tax base to Alamance County. So I encourage the commissioners to favorably approve this proposal put forth by Sheets. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Randy. Mm-hmm. Last row, Mayor Williams, would you like to speak?
No, so I'm here to listen and learn.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Vaughn?
Of course.
Welcome, Ann.
Thank you, commissioners, and it's a pleasure to be here. I think what we need to do here.
And please.
Step on what?
Introduce yourself to everybody.
Step on me. Ann Vaughn. I'm sorry. I think what we need to do here in Alamance County is look again at our business model. We have a lot of building going on in Orange County. We have a lot of building going on in Guilford County. And we're right here in between everything. I'm not saying how to do it. I'm just saying maybe we just need to take a second look. We want to increase the taxable property base here in Alamance County. We want jobs. I want to say personally, thank you, gentlemen, for being here. It's a pleasure. I did some research on the company, on the name of Sheets, and I couldn't find anything but good things about you. So that's where I am. I was on the board when we had contracts for potential companies interested in Alamance County. We held these businesses to those contracts. Right, Clyde? He's had a hard time on some cases, but nevertheless, there were contracts. The word incentive, I think, and I'm going to have to disagree with some of our friends that have come up and spoken, that contracts is a misnomer in this situation. We should refer to it as an investment, and I'm going to explain that. If you have a piece of paper in front of you, if you'll draw a line down the center of that paper, and on the left side put tax per acre on property. Per acre is about $5,500. This is the best I could figure out. About $5,500. On the other side, we have the situation of commercial road front property. And I dare say that that tax would probably double or triple once that becomes commercial property. We put we put a building on it. 200,000 square foot building. I was going through the paper that was on the papers that were in the on the on net, and this is what I came up with: 200 square foot facility, machinery, equipment, more tax dollars. Still nothing's going on the other side of that $5,500 land per acre. They're going to hire, starting with 210 employees full-time. That should increase to about 253 employees within 5 years. These are taxpayers. They are shoppers. I'm going to have to disagree with one gentleman who said something about $23,000 or $24,000 average pay. The last sheet that was on the internet showed that the average pay was going to be, excuse me just a second, I believe it was, yeah, here we go, average wage of all jobs by year 2014 would be $33,976, the average. Yes, there are some lower paying jobs and there are some higher paying jobs, but the average was $33,976 per year. Okay. Land only, residential out there would be $5,500 an acre. What Sheets is talking about, I think, is 40 acres. Okay, 40 acres, that would be $220,000 taxes. Now let's go over to that other side. We have 40 acres of the 150 acres. 40 acres commercial road front property doubles or triples. I'm not sure where that is. Couldn't find out through the tax office today. But if it doubles, it would be $440,000 taxes. Okay. Then you add the facilities, machinery, equipment, etc. This sounds like really a win-win situation for us here in Alamance County. Remember, this is a contract. The county would collect a minimum of $440,000 and pay the company $160,000 a year. I like those odds. If they meet the benchmarks each year beginning August 31st, 2014 till August 31st, 2020. Therefore, the total paid to the company for 7 years is $1,120,000. And this is what a lot of people are fussing about. We're paying them our tax money, but we're collecting from them before we pay them that money. Is that correct?
Yes.
Right. The minimum collected in taxes from this company for 7 years, It's not 1,120,000, it's $3,080,000. We'll pay them $1,120,000 over 7 years, but we will receive from them in that 7 year period $3,080,000. And then after 7 years, we will not be paying them anything. They will be paying those taxes. Plus, we have those people employed, those people out shopping and buying homes at $33,000 average a year. This is indeed an investment, folks. I know there's a lot of discussion on both sides. People for, people against. I don't think people understand. Here in Alamance County, I'm sorry we have to say that word incentive. I think it's an ugly word. I think Alamance County has been very careful in investing in businesses. Take Charlotte, for instance. There's nothing in Charlotte in the beginning. They pulled themselves up by the bootstraps. And they started getting companies and industries into Charlotte, and they grew. I don't want Alamance County to grow like Charlotte. I'm not asking for that, but we do need businesses here. We do need industry here, and this is a wonderful way to get it. I'm tickled to death you guys are here. Ignore some of what you're hearing. Just hear the good part. I wish you luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anna.
Well, no, I'm logistically, I see Ms. Jones waving the fan. I'm a little warm. Is something wrong with the air conditioner?
Yeah, cooking.
Not aware.
Oh, he's starting a meeting.
Can we adjust something a little bit?
Let me see what we can do. Of course, fan
it. We did pay the bill, didn't we, this month?
Barely, but both.
Okay. Next, Ann, I'm sorry, I don't know you all. Would you like to speak? Either? Tom? Mr. McGowan?
What's that on about 9?
You said that before I got up.
I'll just make it a little worse. Thank
you. Good evening to you.
Thank you. I'm Tom McGowan, and I am serving as chairman of the Economic Development Committee of the Chamber. I told Mac I probably wouldn't speak tonight, so he's probably cringing right now that I am going to speak.
He's not looking like he is. Anyway.
Thank you for all you do. I'm a native of Alamance County. I am a small business co-owner here. I hope to die here a long, long time from now. But I hope to spend my whole life here. I have heard the things about how wonderful Alamance County is, and they're correct. I also am pretty certain that we could go to any county in North Carolina or Virginia or any surrounding state and hear, hopefully, if those people are fortunate, how lucky they are to be there and why wouldn't every business want to locate there. The fact is, we can argue, and we all have our own opinions about the propriety of incentives and whether they're good, and I think we would all be sort of in the same direction on that. The fact is, it's the playing field we're on, and we have to recognize that. We have to live with that. What we're dealing with here is not bailing money up and dumping it out the back of the truck in the middle of the night. We're dealing with a carefully constructed contract by our county attorney that involves set benchmarks. It involves strong clawbacks. And it involves investment by Sheets before we invest money. If you compare where Alamance County will be at the end of 10 years, if this deal goes through and we end up paying all of the money versus what Alamance County will have in their coffers if that lot sits empty for the next 10 years, forgetting the additional investment from jobs, from additional employment. I can tell you which way we, the taxpayers of Alamance County, will be better off. Costs are going up. You guys do a masterful job with the budget, and we appreciate that. As a business person, I really appreciate that. The fact is, costs are going to keep going up, and as to the extent they're funded out of property taxes, you either get the money through the tax rate increasing or through increasing the tax base. This increases our tax base, which hopefully will help us keep our rates down. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Mr. Strickland. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak, and thank you for y'all doing considering this incentive package tonight. My name's Keith Strickland. I'm an Elon community resident. I've lived in Alamance County for about 20 years, and I've been an active member of the chamber and currently on the board. I come for you today, like many of these guys. I know there's arguments on both sides, but I like Tom. You know, many of y'all know I work in the banking industry. It's competitive out there. I mean, we always compete, and you know, competition is part of this process too. And I know a lot of people equate it to a beauty contest, but it's not really. I said, you know, these guys have done a masterful job, and welcome to Sheets tonight. You know, they looked at a lot of opportunities across North Carolina and other states, and you know, we had to put our best foot forward. We are in a good strategic location. But as you get further in this process, incentive has become one important factor. You know, this incentive, if it goes through, you know, they're going to provide a lot of jobs. Like you said, this enhances our tax base. I think it's going to be great for our county. I think they'll be a good corporate citizen. And I'm a firm believer in the word catalyst. This will be a catalyst. We haven't had a win in a long time. This will be a catalyst, I think, for many things to come. So I would respectfully ask y'all to consider this and endorse this incentive package. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, Dean. Okay, how about that last row where Dave is? Dave, you want to speak tonight? Y'all? Okay, yes, come forward. Welcome.
Hi. I am Judy Pfeifenberger. I am actually not a resident of Alamance County. I am from Stony Creek, but I felt compelled to come here because it's a public hearing. I lived in Altoona. I'm from Pennsylvania, and I've lived in Altoona, which is where the Sheets Corporation is, their headquarters is, for 14 years. And I got to tell you, they are the best corporation to have in your community. As far, I know everyone else talked about the incentives and everything else, but looking back at a corporation and knowing what are they going to help us and how are they going to help a community grow, you couldn't ask for a better neighbor. I have friends that have lived and worked for that corporation for years. They don't leave once you get a job there. That's how solid a performing corporation it is. And I just think as a community, you need to know that side of it. They participate in their community. They give back to their community. It's not just a building there that's just going to pay their taxes and hire people and not care. They're very caring company, and I just felt like I needed to come and share that and see that other human side of the corporation. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Henry? Welcome back.
Thank you. My name is Henry Vines, and now I am a lifetime resident here in Alamance County. I have just, you know, I have a little bit different respect on this incentives. I know that, and I certainly would want to say welcome to y'all. We want you here in Alamance County, and I would just challenge you to come to Alamance County without taking any money. This county is struggling. As right now as we are. And the numbers that Ann put out are different from the numbers that I figured. because of the investment of $32 million, the tax base right now currently 52 cents, that'd be about $171,000 a year, which we're going to give them 160 of that back. It's not going to cost the county per se any money right up front, but this county needs revenue. And if we don't get this revenue from the tax base increase, then it's going to be a tax, property tax increase to the citizens. And essentially, the citizens of Alamance County are end up going to have to pay for the tax base that these folks are getting back. You can put it any way you want to. That's what it is. This company is receiving a exemption of property taxes for 7 years. It's the same amount or a little less than what they will be paying in each year. They're paying in about 171, they'll get 160 of it back. It has to be, I understand the law, I understand it has to be given as an incentive, but it's basically, I mean, in all essence, it's a return on their property taxes. They're not paying no property taxes. When I built my chicken houses, $300,000, I didn't get no exemption on my property taxes. I started paying right immediately. This company has built two stores here in Alamance County. Both
three.
Of those, that other one's out there on Rankin. Three. No incentives. It's a good business move. It's a profitable move. This county is located strategically to the interstates. It's centrally located in the state. It's centrally located to Virginia, South Carolina, Georgia. You can go to Danville, but you've got to come back to the interstate. So I think y'all have looked at this and you know this is a good place to be. And I don't blame you for asking for the incentive, because it is a good business move. If you can receive funds to help in your company, then by all means you should go after it. I don't have a problem with that. But commissioners, we have right now on the ballot a tax increase. You're asking us, the citizens of Alamance County, to vote for a tax increase for us. And that's through sales tax. Every citizen in Alamance County will be paying. It's a tax increase, any way you look at it. And you're asking us, in the resolution that you're putting forward, to put another $2.5 million of that in the economic development.
Okay, Henry, that is not relevant to this.
Well, I mean,
you can stay on the subject of the public
okay.
hearing.
Okay,
I'm
sorry,
sheets.
Sir. Yeah, okay. But my point being is, commissioners, our county needs revenue. We don't need to be handing out money when we can't afford to. I'd like to have a new tractor, but I can't afford it right now. So I would speak against this incentive, but I certainly would invite y'all and hope that y'all come to Alamance County, you know, and be a citizen of Alamance County and be a participant in Alamance County government by paying property taxes and helping, you know, our community. I know that y'all will be a good, you know, citizen to the county and helping in the programs and all, and we appreciate that as well. But I just think this incentive, we don't need to do this at this time. Thanks.
Thank you, Henry. Mr. Moser? Linda, you getting cooler?
Who's talking to me?
Brian, is it working?
No, we got somebody looking
into it. It's cool. So good. They're probably thinking about 10 Welcome, sir.
Commissioner Manning, commissioners, I'm Sammy Moser, concerned taxpayer. Not necessarily for myself, because I won't have a lot additional years probably to pay taxes here, but I have paid them for several years, and I'm proud to say I love Alamance County. I love all the features that we have in Alamance County, and I'm sure the Sheets representatives recognize the features that we have in the county. I'm proud of it. But I'm concerned about future generations. Several of you folks have children, grandchildren, that are going to be making up the difference in the property of values or tax revenues down the road that we keep cutting the corporations pay. The corporations throughout, not just Alamance County, but throughout North Carolina, throughout the states, corporate tax rate, their share of the tax burden continues to be lower and lower, and the average taxpayer, the struggling taxpayer, has to make up the difference. So I'm concerned about that. Appreciate the opportunity to speak. And I just want to say that I think it was 3 years ago, I attended a economic development hearing down in Raleigh. In fact, our former Senator Tonya Forrest and David Hoyle, Senator David Hoyle, chaired that committee, that meeting. And I remember point blank, Senator Hoyle, the first comments he made about incentives was, they are wrong, they should be against the law, I don't like them. That was his first comments. I remember Rufus Edmiston, former attorney, North Carolina Attorney General and Secretary of State, he stated, I don't know if any of you get up and watch NC-SPAN, comes on Sunday morning at 6:30. For the last three Sundays, for some reason, it hasn't been on, but it's really a very informative program. I heard Rufus Edmiston and all the participants on this particular morning talking about incentives. And Rufus, who was, as I said, was a former Attorney General, Secretary of State, said incentives are wrong. He said they should be against the law. And he said the only reason politicians vote for incentives is because they like to get their picture in the newspaper when they have a groundbreaking. Now, I don't think that's true here in Alamance County, but I'm just wanting to share some comments that have been talked about incentives. I certainly respect chiefs, and I can just ride by your locations here in Alamance County, and it makes me feel good to drive by. So you folks are successful. I'm proud. I commend you for what you're doing. From the heart, I commend you. And we certainly would love to have you in Alamance County. I just feel that it's wrong for the county to have to offer the incentives. I think we need to furnish the infrastructure, the water and sewer, the highway, and that was a question I wanted to ask. How much traffic will you be creating as far as trucks in and out? How much infrastructure is going to have to be required?
I'm not sure this is the time for a question and answer period. We can talk to them about that.
Okay, all right, that'd be fine. Also, I would like to ask, you mentioned comparable benefits to existing employees. Could we get some verification about what type of benefits we're talking about? Because I think just recently, Mr. Curran with the ARMC stated that we need to bring companies in Alamance County that pays hospitalization insurance coverage. So that's the question, just what type of benefit for your employees, if we could address that. And hurriedly, I'll just ask, it looks like the big part of the employees will be low-wage employees. 24,000, 23,000, 37,000. But I noticed that the first year of startup, you're going to have 14 people, and I'm just trying to understand this from a business point. You're going to have 14 employees that will be earning from $73,000 to $83,000 a year, which that is great. But you're going to have these 14 people that will earn that in the startup. But then the balance of the, 4 years that you're showing on the schedule, you're going to be hiring 154 additional employees, and all will be at the lower pay scale. So I just question, do those figures attempt to make the salary level look better, or will you actually hire the 14 employees? Will these be new employees at the higher pay scale to start with? So that was just a question. Like I want to say again, I'm proud when I ride by your locations, and I commend you folks for your company, the success. I just want to ask, though, if you, when you go to bed tonight, you've heard the comments about the financial situation that Alamance County's in, not only Alamance County, but many counties. You've heard the comments. How are you going to feel tonight when you go to bed knowing the success you have endured, the hardships to create your success, that you're successful, but you're going to have 249 employees that are working for you at a low wage level, and they're going to have to somehow down the road make up the difference in the revenue to our county that we're talking about giving you in incentives. And how would our commissioners feel? Because if you make this decision, to me it's just sort of unfair. So I'm just asking to think, I appreciate the opportunity to speak, think down the road. One other question I might ask, if in fact we had leadership here that went to our local representative members and went to Congress and we changed this incentive issue and there was no incentives on the table, would you folks, would you stay in Alamance County? Or where would you go? And maybe tell us a little bit about what you like about Alamance County. I love our county. I love the community college, the Elon University. I love going over there. And City Park, it's just a great place for kids. We got great schools. So that's my thinking. I'd like to hear from you folks what you think about Alamance County.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you for speaking. Mm-hmm. Opportunity.
I don't know. I can't see the gentleman behind me. Did you wish to speak, sir? Linda, Richard?
Mr. Chairman, I wrote a speech and we somehow ended on, called it, somehow stole it. I think I read it word for word.
I'm sorry.
So you do not wish to speak. Okay. The row, then we're back to the row. Susan, you want to speak?
Not tonight.
Mac, is there anyone in your row that is not part of the Sheets delegation, or would any of the Sheets folks like to follow up?
If Ray wants to address the questions that Mr. Moser asked or others, I think that would probably be, there's nothing else I can
add. Okay. Ray, that's up to you if you'd like to speak.
I would just like to answer any questions the board has. I could take many days philosophically about ways to do business or not do business, and I just want to answer the board's question.
Okay, and we'll do that momentarily. Are there any other speakers?
Mr. Chairman, it's not a speech, but a question, and maybe you're going to do it in the next segment. In other words, are you going to have someone, staff or yourself, someone outline exactly what the agreement itself is?
We can do it again.
All right.
I mean, I said that when we announced the public hearing, and I'll be happy to do it again. But let me first entertain a motion that the public hearing be closed. Is there such a motion?
I'll make a motion. Close.
Is there a second?
Yeah.
Thank you, Tim. Any discussion about closing the public hearing? Not all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Public hearing has been completed. Thank you all for your input. That's what makes our county diverse, and that's what makes it interesting. Let me address Mr. Boney's question, and then I'll open it to staff and other board members for any comments. But basically, the incentive package, Mr. Boney, is that the $32 million approximately in investment with 253 jobs would be accompanied by a $1.12 million county incentive over a seven-year period once certain benchmarks of jobs and investments have been met. It comes out to approximately $160,000 annually over 7 years. Let me ask Craig or Clyde if there's anything that you guys would like to add at this point before we open it up to commissioner discussion.
You do have a revised agreement in front of you that we've been working on up till about 7:45 this evening, and trying to make sure we have the breakdown of what the benchmarks are and make sure that it's clear for everybody involved. So there's still some minor tweaking that may be involved in the language. However, substantively, the time frame of 7 years and the benchmark of 32.838 million dollars and 253 jobs would not change. Is that fair to say, Tom?
That's correct.
Thank you, Craig. Let's before we entertain this as an action item, let's hear from any commissioners that would like to speak at this time.
I've got a few questions. Do you mind coming up, Ray? So that way we can get you on the tape and everything. To follow up on some questions they were asking, the traffic increase in that area, which is a concern, what is your anticipated truckload in and out every day coming?
We haven't done an official traffic study yet. We've been looking at it at various locations. We've been researching. But we will probably start, I can give you a starting number, in 2015. We would probably be running about six tractor trailers, six to eight out a day. And the smaller Sprinter vans, they would probably be about 10 to 12 of those trucks leaving a day. And then we run at night, we go out in the afternoon, they deliver at night, and come back in the morning.
And what states will you service out of this location?
This location naturally will service North Carolina.
Right.
We'll service West Virginia, Southern West Virginia, and we'll go up into Virginia. And this facility will probably service over to Richmond, across and up into Lynchburg and Staunton, however you pronounce it. Mm-hmm. We have the capability, but we have to operate naturally within the DOT regulations, but as far as we can go out and back.
You're not servicing anything south of us?
We don't have anything south of
where we're at. Okay, so is that a future plan for Sheets? I'm guessing
I think we have 10 locations on the docket for next year for us. And
so that's how we ended up in the center of your thought process.
Well, the center is, when you look at it from Sheets' perspective, right now I drive a truck from Claysburg south, and I drive usually four to five of those a day, plus an additional one that has the fresh product on, and I go back empty. Whether that's, it's there's no center, because I don't know where we're going to be in 5 years, let alone right. 10, but so the center that the geographic area we looked at, there was about a 100-mile radius that we were looking at and considering.
So you narrowed it on down to our little.
Yeah, we were, wouldn't deny everybody's been right on the money. They should be in logistics about the center, but there's a lot of other considerations with labor, certainly as part of the incentive package is very attractive.
Wow. And one last question on the benefits that you do offer these employees. I'm guessing, do you have health and care?
Healthcare, eye, dental. We pay a little over 70% of that for the employees. We also have offer them a 401k match that is, we pay 3%. We match 3%, up to dollar for dollar. We also have an employee stock option program. Once they're here for a year and they will be working full time and they're over 18 years of age, they don't have a choice. We give them stock in the company. And we're currently doing a study on retirement funding for our employees to make sure that we can counsel them and guide them towards enough money at retirement to support the current lifestyle they're used to. So we take our responsibility to our employees pretty seriously. Yes, I've been with the organization 35 years. Have we always been like that? No. But as we've grown And as we've had to change to remain competitive in the market for employees, I think they've really become a good corporate citizen.
Well, and I'm going to comment to the lady's comment from Altoona, because I know a couple years ago that your company here supplied quite a few lunches or helped Habitat when we were building a house with the Habitat bill. And we appreciate your corporate involvement in our community, which is very important.
Has all of your growth been internal, or have you purchased other companies on the way, or do you care to respond to that?
Many years ago, probably halfway through my career, 20 couple years ago, we did purchase a couple stores in West Virginia. They didn't work out. We sold those, but we do everything usually greenfield.
Yes. I just want to say, you know, we have three sheet stores in Alamance County right now, and that's the tax base right there. You know, we have to look at that too. I mean, they're already here. And I don't have any problem at all with incentives, because people don't understand how incentives work, I don't think. We don't lose money. When a company moved out of Mebane not long ago, I got a call, and they said, well, how are you going to get your $1 million back that you give them as an incentive? I said, we didn't give them a nickel. We did not give them not one nickel, because they didn't meet their benchmarks, because they have to meet the criteria that we say, and they have to meet the benchmarks. And until Sheets meets their benchmarks, we're not going to give you any money either. So, but I'm proud to, I really am looking forward to this distribution center coming, because we certainly need those jobs. And that's what I'm saying about people not really understanding. Craig, have we ever lost any money on this? Maybe one time.
What? One time that I'm aware.
One time. We lost some money.
We're
but
still looking for them.
That's right. No. We're still after them, I'm telling you. But, you know, and I've been on here 3 years. I'm going on four. And, you know, one loss is, how many have we had, Matt, for goodness sakes? A lot. You know, we've given a lot of incentives. And like I said, if we only lose just one time, we're good. And so I really am happy to say that I want y'all here in Alamance County.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions for Mr. Ryan while he's up?
No questions. I'll have some comments.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right, board members, other comments? Tim?
Well, we'll go ahead with the expected. No offense, I want to show you my Sheets membership card. So certainly, my comments are all personal and all. You've got a great company. I shop there quite often. As a matter of fact, I enjoy your three hot dog special. Got it. Got it last Friday, as a matter of fact. With my grandson, we were going over to Greensboro. But what I really don't understand is why the beer cooler opens every time I walk by. And I don't go in the beer cooler, I'll assure you, but it opens every time I walk by. On a serious note, I've been here 18 and a half years. Too long for a lot of people, and maybe not long enough for some others, but I don't know who they are by name. But I voted for incentives for quite a while, and it was always a vote that you wish you didn't have to make. Basically, held your nose when you made the vote. And you know, we all believed. I believed at that time, yes, you got to do it, or you're going to be viewed as anti-business, not progressive, just not with it. So when I changed was back when a developer in Greensboro, this is what did it for me. A developer in Greensboro was trying to get incentives for a Walmart, and it was well publicized. And at that time I thought, okay, I've really had it. And so I started voting no, and haven't turned back since, haven't turned around since. You know, we've had comments up here, well, retail's retail, we wouldn't do it for retail, but we'll do it for another type of job. You know, a job's a job's a job. $14 an hour is $14 an hour, no matter whether you're making it on one side of a type of business or another. This is not anti-business as far as the way I look at it. I'm looking at it as the way government ought to work. There are things with incentives that if private business did it, a bank, for instance. Now, Tom, you're in banking. I would assume if you gave a client thousands of dollars to bring you their business, is that done?
No.
Okay. That's not done. I didn't check into it. I was hoping the banking industry hadn't changed that much since I left it. But, you know, private business can't do it. But government can. I don't understand that rationality. Now, John and I have disagreed. We'll disagree again tonight, as we did last time. You said it a little sweeter this time than you did last time, but you said in one breath that it was irrational to vote against these, blanket-wise, but that we needed to change it. Now, I find that to be truly not even, I mean, what's irrational is that statement, in my opinion. No offense. I like you, John. John knows, John and I talk a lot. But it's irrational to say, in my opinion, that we need to change it. But it's irrational to try to do it at your level. We passed a resolution here. I put in the resolution a few years ago. Now, the resolution was approved 3-2. Ms. Massey opposed it, and Ms. Vaughn opposed it, if I'm not mistaken. And the resolution was to our state legislators to stop incentives at the local level. And if the state wanted to do it, fine. But knock out this opportunity for cities to go against cities, counties to go against counties. Even Greensboro has tried to come up with a policy of where the three cities, High Point, Winston-Salem, and Greensboro, aren't going to compete with each other. I'm not sure how that's going to play out. But it's strange that the government tells you that you can't give a tax rebate or you can't have tax abatements or whatever the word is, but you can turn around and give cash. Now, if that doesn't slap me as being the most irresponsible logic of good government, I've never seen one. Now, Tony Forrest met with me one day back here in the back room, and we talked about five issues. Incentives was one of the topics we talked about. Tony Forrest was a state senator, looked at me and said he didn't realize it was allowed, that it was being done. And I had somebody in finance, Susan, I think you were the one. You went back and got a check. I requested a check to be brought into the room. It was $36,000 that was given to a particular business. And Tony Forrest looked at me and said he didn't realize it was being allowed, that it was being done. I'm for infrastructure. I support the sales tax referendum, the portion that if it's approved and the referendums on the school ACC is voted down, I am in favor of keeping the sales tax that we can designate to economic development. I'm for it, but I'm not for cash. There's a big difference between setting up infrastructure, water, roads, a park, or whatever, buildings, that other people can hook onto. And there's just a big difference with me when it comes to cash versus infrastructure, hardened infrastructure. So I'm not anti-business. I'm for good government. I'm for the continuity of government being what you might expect. If it's illegal for a business to do it, why in the world would it be legal for a government to do it? Oxymoron, whatever the word is. I mean, that just slaps of not the logic I grew up with and the way I've always led my life. Yes, I do things in my personal life and professional life that probably has cost me. And in my political life, it's cost me. But I've spoken out about the things I disagree with, and I've taken a stand, even if it was going to hurt me. And so I'm not anti-sheets. Trust me, I'm not. I'll probably be there tomorrow. But I'm against giving someone cash, but not, you know, and doing it in a fashion that business can't do it to where it would be illegal. You'd go to jail for it, in my opinion. if it was big enough, you'd go to jail for it. I know bankers all across two states I've lived in where they went to prison because they did things that they thought they wanted to do within their bank, but it was against the law, technically. Malfeasance, so forth and so on. But that's my principle. I'm not against sheets. Trust me, I'm not. And I am for infrastructure placement and incentives to put hardened infrastructure. But to turn around and hand somebody a check that they can go cash for thousands of dollars. Now, so you've got my position, and I'm not ashamed of it, and I'm going to stick on it as long as I'm sitting here. Now, from here to the future. 6 to 7 years now. Is this the first time we've ever gone 7 years?
Yes, sir. That I've been here. Yes, yeah. Sir.
The best of my memory, I thought we had a policy. Y'all say you can't find it now. That's interesting. But the best of mine, that sounds sarcastic, I apologize. But I do remember, I thought some type of policy that we had that said that the break-even point of what we get versus what's paid in, what we pay out, so forth, whatever you want to call it, was 6 years. So here we've gone 7. You know, next time it might be 8. I mean, at what point do we draw that line? I think that's got to be revisited. I appreciate the time, opportunity to speak. I hope you stay here. We've got low taxes. I'm sure you know that. We've got cheap water, excellent transportation, access, and we've got labor at a reasonable cost. And I would hope that we could sell our community on more of that than this. And I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Any other comments? If there are no other comments, this is an action item on our agenda. Is there a motion to approve the proposed incentive package as outlined in the draft agreement that Craig and Clyde gave us right before the meeting that outlines the specifics, but in summary form, for a $32 million investment, approximately 253 jobs, full-time jobs, the county will commit $1.12 million over a 7-year period once benchmarks of jobs and investments that are outlined here have been met, comes out to about $160,000 annually over 7 years. Is there such a motion for approval?
I'll make a motion that we approve this.
I second it.
Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Thank you. And again, thanks to all who have contributed input to tonight's public hearing and this discussion.
Yeah, you can leave it up there.
Do you want me to hang around? Yeah, I can hang around. Let me escort them out, and I'll be back.
Yes, sir. Take care.
So what?
Yeah. Keep those hot dogs free for $1.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Can we have a 5-minute bathroom break?
About a 3-minute break.
About a 3-minute break.
How about a 5-minute break?
Please.